Hi, let's talk about intercostal spaces. So the thorax is surrounded by a bony cage comprised of 12 thoracic vertebrae, their associated 12 pairs of ribs, and a sternum. Now these ribs are numbered 1 through 12, and the intercostal spaces are found between the ribs and the costal cartilages, which connect the ribs to the sternum. So every intercostal space, of which there are 11, is named for the rib superior to it. So this is the first intercostal space, the second intercostal space, all the way down to the 11th intercostal space. These intercostal spaces are filled with muscles and neurovasculature. Remember that the thoracic cage is kind of a dynamic space, that ribs or those costovertebral joints are somewhat mobile, and ribs can therefore swing upward and outward, or they can swing downward and inward. Now there are three layers of muscles that we're responsible for, the most superficial of which are called the external intercostal muscles. They're called that because they are the most external. These external intercostal muscles have fibers which are running inferomedially. So from the rib above to the rib below in this inferomedial direction. They're more complete posterolaterally, and in the anterior, they're represented more by their fascia, so it's more of a membranous look to it. These external intercostal muscles, when they contract, they're going to pull ribs upward and outward, thereby increasing the volume of the thoracic cavity, thereby aiding in inspiration. The internal intercostal muscles are deep to the external intercostal muscles, and from this line here down to about that line there, the external intercostal muscles have been dissected away. We can still see them at that level and at that level. But looking at the internal intercostal muscles, we can see that their fibers move inferolaterally, like so. They're more distributed in the intercostal space anterolaterally and less so posteriorly, so they're more membranous posteriorly. They'll be more represented by their fascia. And these internal intercostal muscles, when they pull, they're going to tug the ribs downward and inward, thereby decreasing volume of the thoracic cavity, thereby working with other muscles for forced exhalation. Now, deep to the internal intercostal muscles are the innermost intercostal muscles. And let me orient you to this image. So the wall of the thorax has been cut and it has been reflected downward. So that way is inferior. That way is superior. But in terms of the rib cage here, we're looking at a superior and inferior. So the clavicles are here. And we can see the innermost intercostal muscles, which have more of a superior-inferior orientation with them. What's interesting about the innermost intercostal muscles is that their function is akin to the internal intercostal muscles. So they'll pull the ribs downward so as to aid in forceful exhalation. And the neurovascular bundles are going to be found between the internal and the innermost intercostal muscles, as we'll see shortly. One other thing that I'd like to draw your attention to is that there are slips of this muscle called the transversus thoracis. You're not responsible for identifying it in this session, but it is helpful to see how the internal thoracic arteries and veins are going to be found deep to this muscle. So let's take a look at a deeper level here. So over here, we've had between these two lines, the innermost intercostal muscles removed from the intercostal space. So the muscles that we're seeing here are internal intercostal muscles. And we can see the neurovascular bundles. These neurovascular bundles are found at the superior margin of the intercostal space, just deep to the rib. There's a subcostal groove such that the rib provides protection to this bundle. There's going to be a vein, an artery, and a nerve in this bundle. And the vein will be the closest element, we can see it here, the closest element to the rib, then the artery, and then the nerve. So we have an intercostal vein, an intercostal artery, and then an intercostal nerve. In terms of the collateral branch, that's usually very small and hard to find. That'll be found at the bottom edge of the intercostal space. And that order is flipped, but the vein is still closest to the rib. So we'll have an intercostal collateral nerve branch, and then an intercostal collateral artery branch, and then an intercostal collateral venous branch. The veins are sourced from two places. They're going to drain either anteriorly via anterior intercostal veins into the internal thoracic veins, or they'll drain posteriorly into the azygos system. And we'll see the azygos system when we discuss the posterior mediastinum. The intercostal arteries are anastomoses between anterior intercostal branches of the internal thoracic arteries, which we can see here, and posterior intercostal arteries coming from the thoracic aorta, which we won't see until we get to the posterior mediastinum. The dominant blood supply, though, is going to be from the posterior intercostal arteries. The intercostal nerves are going to be ventral primary rami of thoracic nerves 1 through 11. And that first thoracic nerve, the bulk of that ventral primary ramus is going superiorly to the brachial plexus, which we'll see in greater detail in subsequent laboratories. And the remainder of T1 will then serve as the intercostal nerve for that first space. Finally, let's take a look at the internal thoracic artery. So over here, here's the manubrium of the sternum, the clavicles. So this is sort of an inferior anterior view of the thoracic wall, but here's the diaphragm. So the thoracic wall has been flipped down upon the abdominal wall so as to take this view. And the transversus thoracis muscle has been reflected away. And we're able to see that internal thoracic artery and, in this case, two internal thoracic veins. The internal thoracic artery has several branches to it. The first being the pericardiacophrenic artery. That pericardiacophrenic artery we can see branching off just there at the superior portion or the proximal portion of the artery. It's going to descend down the mediastinum between the heart and the lungs, or between the pericardium and the pleura, and we can see it accompanying the phrenic nerve on the way down to the diaphragm. So pericardiacophrenic, it's going to supply the pericardium as well as the diaphragm with blood. Coming off of that internal thoracic artery, we'll also have the anterior intercostal branches, so for the first six intercostal spaces. And then we have the branching of the musculophrenic artery and the superior epigastric artery. The musculophrenic artery, and I'm sorry, to be honest with you, superior epigastric is there in this case, not there. So we have musculophrenic and superior epigastric. The musculophrenic artery is going to follow down along the costal margin, and then it will continue to give anterior intercostal branches for intercostal spaces 7 through 9. And the superior epigastric artery is going to be the blood supply to the rectus abdominis muscle. There's going to be an inferior epigastric artery that will anastomose with it, that we'll see in the GI sequence. So these are the branches of the internal thoracic artery. I think of them as PAMS, P-A-M-S. We've discussed the intercostal space and the blood supply to and from that in this video, and we've discussed the branches of the internal thoracic artery. Thank you very much for your time.